common site is the left colon and the distal colon. These two are about 50%. Right colon, which historically was said to occur at about 10%, occurs in anywhere from 23 to 25% of cases. But the important thing to understand is that any part of the colon can be involved with ischemic colitis. And if you have just rectal involvement, those are usually young women with autoimmune disease. The outcomes vary depending on the anatomic patterns of disease. So for example, right colon has twice the rate of surgery and twice the mortality rate of all comers. That's the worst, right colon and pan colon. So right colon ischemia is a bad prognosis. And here you can see this in terms of days to death in these hospitalized patients. Right colon pattern, all other patterns of disease on this Kaplan-Meier curve. Now, the reason for that is not well known, but we know that the superior mesenteric artery supplies the bulk of the small bowel and the right colon. Acute mesenteric ischemia has a terrible prognosis. If you don't make the diagnosis within 48 hours, that patient is going to have anywhere between an 80% and 100% mortality from acute mesenteric ischemia, whether it's non-occlusive variety or occlusive variety. Colon ischemia doesn't come close to that. Right colon does, and right colon with a little bit of small bowel, terminal ileum involved, has the same mortality as acute mesenteric ischemia. So it has a worse prognosis than ischemia involving any other segment of disease. Well, one of the things we've been trying to devise now is a means of determining how sick a patient is with this. And there are a lot of things in the world's literature. Clinical presentation, and now I'm giving you a summation of the world's literature. Some of these are better studies than others, and we are now doing the study, we're in the process of doing the study, to find out which ones, without relying on the laboratory, you can judge. They'll tell you what you should do with the patient. But abdominal pain without rectal bleeding, why? Suggests right-sided disease. Non-bloody diarrhea suggests right-sided disease. Peritoneal signs, that's obvious. And symptom onset after hospital admission. A lot of things go into that. It's a very complicated overall term. If a patient comes in, when they come to your attention, with tachycardia or hypotension. If a patient has a hemoglobin less than 12, a low sodium, a high LDH, a high BUN, a low bicarb, a low albumin, a high white count. Those are the factors that are most useful in determining whether a patient is at a higher risk.
Dr. Brandt, do you use lactic acid?
I'm sorry?
Is there a level of lactic acid where you feel it?
No, high, but there's no higher than.
There's none that you'd feel more comfortable with it. If they've got a bump in the lactic acid, does that automatically make
them? Well, a little bump I wouldn't be so concerned about. But if they have a significant and persistent elevation, then I would suspect that they have dead bowel. Yes?
How would you explain non-bloody diarrhea from the right side?
That's a very good question. I don't have a good answer for it, but I will tell you that not every patient with ischemic colitis on the left side has bloody diarrhea either. Okay? And it may be that patients may develop diarrhea, become hypotensive, develop ischemic colitis, and it can be on the right side. So diarrhea may be an expression of the ischemia and may be something which caused the ischemia. By the time you got to the patient, they had ischemia. The presentation a day before they became hypotensive from the diarrhea, was non-bloody diarrhea. So it may be initially unrelated even. and then related, and then the patient doesn't do well and dies because they have right-sided disease and they never have a chance to manifest bloody diarrhea. So in terms of treating patients with colon ischemia, most patients don't require specific therapy. They resolve spontaneously. So for the most part, the treatment's conservative and supportive, maintain their cardiac output, replace their volume losses, and call a surgeon if you need to call a surgeon. When do you need to call a surgeon? Let me see if I have a slide on that. I took it out to shorten the talk. Well, you would call a surgeon, obviously, if your patient had acute abdomen. If a patient wasn't getting better after 7 days, because patients with colon ischemia that don't improve within the first 5 days tend not to do as well. And if they go 10 days, then you would start considering them for colectomy. When are antibiotics indicated? Well, in the past, we did several studies in dogs and showed that if you administered antibiotics before you induced ischemic injury, the dogs that got the antibiotics did better than the dogs that didn't get the antibiotics. The ischemic injury is less severe, less of bowel was involved, prognosis was better, survival was better. Today, using mice or other rodents, if you ligate the SMA and subject them to then delayed reperfusion, you can then study the effects of more current antibiotics. The antibiotics that we used up here are antibiotics that probably very few people in this room have heard of. But these studies have been done with current antibiotics, and what they show is that you get less bacterial translocation, you get less inflammation, you get fewer toll-like receptors, you have a decreased complement, the inflammatory pathway seems to be aborted, or truncated, or minimized, or mitigated. So the antibiotic that we recommend is an anti-anaerobic agent, plus a fluoroquinolone and aminoglycoside, or a third generation cephalosporin. And you can use Clinda. Clinda is an acceptable antibiotic. And we recommend that in any of the patients that we judge as being severely ill at the present time. Let me go back and show you a somewhat complicated slide, but let me show you this slide. This is something that we put together based upon the literature. I don't really love it, but it's an attempt, and now we're making this much tighter. It's an attempt to evaluate patients as having mild, moderate, or severe disease. Mild would be segmental colitis, none of the risk factors for a poor outcome. And those are the ones that we describe. But one of the ones in the literature is male gender. I don't really like that. I mean, essentially 50% of the population is male gender. So immediately, you're giving half the population, you know, a bad mark. Men get bad marks for a lot of things. This shouldn't be one of the things. So we took that out of the system that we're trying to put together now. But if you have a patient who comes in, they're hypotensive, they're tachycardic, they have a white count that's high, their BUN is high, their albumin is low, that would be enough for me to say, this person has moderately severe disease. If they have peritoneal findings, pneumatosis, gangrene, a pancolonic distribution of disease, or an isolated distribution of disease to the right colon, I would give that patient antibiotics. If somebody came into the office and said, I had rectal bleeding for the last day, I have some discomfort here, right? But I think I'm getting better, and you colonoscope them and you see it's ischemic colitis, and their white count is normal, and their albumin is normal, and their BUN is normal, I wouldn't stop them on antibiotics.
Dr. Brandt, do you worry at all about treating a toxigenic E. coli? You know, some of those patients may be E. coli presentations.
They may. In a study that I did a long time ago, I showed that about 10% of patients have an infectious etiology. The majority of those at that time were E. coli 15787. And we actually developed a specific stain, the E. coli 15787, that the AFIP is using now for their cases. The theory here is that E. coli, or hemorrhagic colitis caused by E. coli, if you give antibiotics to that patient, it'll kill the E. coli. When you kill the E. coli, it'll release its Shiga toxins. It makes two types of Shiga toxins that cause damage to the vasculature and to the mucosa. And if that happens, it may have a worse prognosis. So for E. coli 15787, most people don't use antibiotics. I can't say that I've ever noticed a direct correlation between antibiotic use and patient disease course, where they were going along and then we introduced antibiotics and then they took a turn for the worse. Most of the time they start bad, continue bad, and we do something, or if they're doing well, they usually do well. They don't have delayed complications, and the antibiotics would be more of a delayed complication.
If you don't have an artificial heart valve, what are you treating with antibiotics?
Well, you're looking at a You're looking at an injury that is really an infected infarct. And you have a bacterial translocation that occurs, probably in the majority of the cases, we don't document it. But that's what you're treating. You're treating, white count was normal, I probably would use antibiotics. But in a patient who's sick, I would use it, because those are the patients that develop delayed complications of infection, and I think it's related to bacterial transmission.
We tend to treat everybody before we see them with antibiotics, regardless.
I try not to let that happen, but you're right.
We have the same kind of thing in ulcerative colitis. We give antibiotics, and the data's shown that there's less mortality in the severe, people. So if they do perf, if you have them on antibiotics, there's less death.
You gotta wonder if they're not getting better butts.
Don't forget that in presentation blood flow is normal.
Yeah, it's
no, good. But in ulcerative colitis, maybe they become dehydrated.
I just think that you get bacteremia, you could die. And if you got antibiotics on board, you probably get less chance of that.
An area that needs a lot of work.
In that group that you just defined, you've got in your mind, you have a moderate to severe patient. What do you think the mortality is in that population?
30% to 40%.
Wow.
Yeah, these are sick people.
Yeah.
You have mentioned anticoagulation. You coming to that at all?
No. We don't use any anticoagulation for these patients.
Heparin sub-Q just because they're in the hospital?
I don't think heparin sub-Q would necessarily hurt, but as a routine, we don't do it. The only ischemic injury that we recommend it for is mesenteric venous thrombosis. But, heparin is a funny thing. I mean, who would ever think that a patient with ulcerative colitis could be heparinized and not bleed to death. Mm-hmm. But in fact,
they're hypercoagulable.
Yes, they are. They have a chronic disease. Yeah. They're in bed, they're in the hospital. They're hypercoagulable, but the index case from Ireland was done for a patient with ulcerative colitis that had a pulmonary embolus. So, risk of hemorrhage versus certainty of death. Okay, I'll go for the risk. So you give him the, and what happened? The ulcerative colitis got better. Right? I forgot his name.
Shannon? Bernie Shannon?
No, it wasn't him.
Before him, it was Jason.
Yeah, no, it was before him. Yeah. I just don't remember his name anymore. It's a short Irish name. That was the index case of the use of ulcerative heparin in the treatment of ulcerative colitis. And for a while, it was hotly studied. And then, it's not used so much anymore, or at all. But I wouldn't be afraid to use heparin in a patient with ulcerative colitis, even if their mucosa looked like a hand grenade.
I think females are more hypercoagulable, in my experience, than males with inflammatory bowel disease in general.
I have
to term stroke incidents.
Yeah, I don't. I've never looked at that. So the challenges in studying ischemia are: it's a benign and self-limited disease. Usually, the diagnosis is assumed; it's not proven. There's no definite ICD-10 code for it, so it's hard to do literature searches on this. And the future directions, I think, have a lot to do with etiology and physiology. This may be a small vessel disease, very small. It could be venular rather than arteriolar. The interaction between coagulation, inflammatory disease, and immune reactions, that's a real hot area. We'd like to know who are patients who are at risk for colon ischemia, who are the patients at risk for recurrent disease, or chronic disease, or complicated disease. And we may come to this with serologic testing and microvascular imaging and maybe endoscopy. And if you can identify those patients, maybe then you can give them some prophylactic therapy, or you'll know how to treat them when they come in. This is something that I published a long time ago. It was on IBD markers and colon ischemia. And basically, the summary, they were positive in a lot of cases. Mm-hmm. And showing that, first of all, they're not pathognomonic for IBD, but it shows you that maybe, there's an immune component to the genesis of colon ischemia, and maybe an immunosuppressive agent would be appropriate. If the right one could be chosen for the right period of time, you don't need it for a long period of time because most of these patients get better by themselves, but for the chronic patients, the recurrent patients, it's an interesting area for study. So the take-home points I have for you on two slides. Colon ischemia is an increasingly common disease, and you should consider when a patient, particularly an elderly patient, presents with rectal bleeding, bloody diarrhea, or abdominal pain. The site of involvement determines the presentation and the prognosis. If it's not isolated to the right side, it presents with rectal bleeding or bloody diarrhea, more so than abdominal pain, and has a good outcome. If it occurs on the isolated right colon, abdominal pain is a more dramatic component than is rectal bleeding or bloody diarrhea, and that has a poorer outcome. Evaluation is by CT and colonoscopy, not angiography, except maybe for isolated right disease. CT is a good screening test and may help determine prognosis, and colonoscopy is the best test for confirming the diagnosis. And broad-spectrum antibiotics are good for patients with moderate to severe disease. So I think we'll stop there.
That was such a treat. You don't get lectures from that have that historical perspective. It really kind of helps. All the barium studies, a lot of the insights that you brought up wouldn't be even brought up nowadays because you don't see barium that was ever shown. So I'll just grab the first question. Give me an example of the isolated right colonic ischemia. Give me a case that, you're on service now, fellow presents this case to you, and then you set off the alarms because you're going to alert the fellow this is something we got to worry about. This could be an isolated, right? And now we should do this, this, and this.
All right, so the case is a 53-year-old man with stage 4 CKD. I'll present it like my fellows. CKD on HD. They don't speak English anymore. I don't think a day goes by that I don't say to one of them, what does this mean? Yeah. What does that mean? But a 57-year-old person, chronic kidney disease on hemodialysis, and we're called after the dialysis session because the patient has right side of abdominal pain. I don't need it anymore. I'm done. I consider isolated right colonoscopy. And what I would look at is the weight of the patient before and after. This usually occurs when they've been overdialyzed and they've lost weight. So what's happening? They've lost weight, they're hypovolemic, they have a little bit of hypertension when they sit up, and their SMA is contracted. And this turns out to be a non-occlusive process involving the small bowel and or the right colon. The very first patient we had with isolated right colon ischemia came into the hospital with right sided abdominal pain, and an older woman, well, not that much, 63 to 67, somewhere in that range. And we saw that they had ischemia, and they were doing well, so we sent them home. Mm. 2 weeks later, they came back to the hospital with an acute abdomen and had acute mesenteric ischemia, and on angiography had an embolus in the SMA and wound up dying. And the way we constructed the case, retrospectively, is that the person came into the hospital because of a superior mesenteric artery embolus, presenting with isolated right colon ischemia, shared blood supply. We weren't aware of it. We didn't study for the embolus. They went home, and they had continued damage, continued ischemia, and infarcted the small bowel. So the situations you see it in, often, if you want to think of it that way, are dialysis patients, and patients oftentimes who have atrial fibrillation, your typical superior mesenteric artery embolus case. Now, how does a typical embolus present? Typical small bowel embolus presents with sharp abdominal pain, like that. Because what happens is when the embolus lodges in the vessel, you get a contraction of the SMA, and you get a reflex hyperperistalsis of the small bowel. So the typical story, you don't get it often, but the absolutely characteristic history of an SMA embolus is somebody who is awakened from sleep with a sharp abdominal pain and explosive diarrhea. And in the lab, if you open a dog's belly and you put in an embolus, you put in a clot into the analog of the superior mesenteric artery, and you just watch the colon and you watch the small bowel, you see the small bowel start to go like this within about a minute and a half. Turns a little bluish, a little reddish, and then starts the peristalsis goes like this, and the dog has a bowel movement. That's typical. They come into the hospital and they have continued abdominal pain. Well, at that point, if you don't make the diagnosis, that patient's in trouble. Because if the surgery department is called, the resident comes down, the chief resident comes down. They have to call the attending. By the time all of these delays occur, the bowel is already dead. And the only time that you can save the bowel is if you act soon enough to prevent the vasoconstriction that occurs upon the embolus seating itself in the vessel. Because what happens is this vasoconstriction is an attempt to preserve mesenteric pressure. And initially it's protective, but this is reversible only for a short period of time, 24 hours, 18 hours. After that time, all of this vasoconstriction that occurred distal to the obstruction is irreversible. So if you operate on the patient and you take out the obstruction and you remove all the dead bowel, you haven't done anything about the vasoconstriction. And that's why the natural history of this is, patient goes to the operating room, the embolus is removed, dead bowel is removed, they closed up, they brought back. 2 days later, they have recurrent abdominal pain, they brought back to the operating room, they have another 2 feet of dead bowel. Dead bowel's removed, ends up brought back together, this, and it goes back and forth until they have a short bowel, and or they die. So the treatment of this should be the removal of an embolus and the intra-arterial infusion of a vasodilator, either papaverine or prostaglandin E2, G2, PGE2, prostaglandin E2, which is what's done. And the reason it's done is to prevent that vasoconstriction. I'm not sure I answered you.
No, that was wonderful. Thanks.
Your thoughts on bowel prep? Because previous literature mentioned they do, the bowel prep may potentially worsen ischemia and then surveillance, how about colonoscopy?
anything that dehydrates a patient can do this. So colon ischemia has been described with almost every bowel prep that you can imagine. Bisacodyl alone. Go lightly alone. I don't know prep, pig, soup prep, those, but if you have significant diarrhea, and significant diarrhea can cause colon ischemia. You're causing significant diarrhea, okay? So it happens. In terms of follow-up, I don't think any follow-up is necessary. I don't think, when you said surveillance,
I assume. For example, if somebody had ischemic colitis and then for example, if it looks like cancer and if it's if the biopsies are negative and it was ischemia and sample.
If it looks like cancer to you, mm-hmm. and your biopsies are negative, go back the next day and biopsy them again. If I think it's cancer, I'm going to act as if it's cancer. I'm going to prove it or I'm going to disprove it. So as soon as those biopsies come back, I say, God, I thought that was a cancer. Maybe the cancer's deeper. Do it again. When you go back, it may look very different.
But otherwise, for non-massive, just typical.
Routine colon ischemia, I don't do a follow-up.
So, on one hand, you're saying that they often associated with distal or proximal cancers. And you're saying if you reach the distal end of the ischemia, don't go any farther, just take biopsies and come out.
Because the lesion is distal to the ischemia in the vast majority of cases.
Well,
the cancer.
But not always, right?
Not always.
I guess the question is, do you go for colonoscopy and how long do you wait before you feel that you can go and examine the entire colon?
Well, it depends on what I'm seeing the patient for. If I'm seeing the patient because of bloody diarrhea, and I go in and I see, oh, I'm in 18 centimeters, and look at this. This is typical ischemia. I stop. I take my biopsies and I stop. Now, why would I want to do a follow-up colonoscopy? Is this patient deserving of a screening colonoscopy? She's never had one. Well, if she's never had one,
I'll bring her back to do a screening colonoscopy. If she's had one and is due for another one, I'll bring her back to do another one. If the person is 30 years of age, I won't do her. We okay, or you don't like that?
I'm not very convinced, but it's okay.
Okay. So I've had a few over the years of, and I'm thinking now they're usually female, and not so much older females, but recurrent ischemic events. And boy, I, you know, they come to me, I was, you know, a research student, and I was going to come up with some big idea. There were no big ideas. I don't know if there are.
If I had a patient, a young woman with recurrent colon ischemia, I'd send them to a research IBD immunologist too. forgive me. So I see a lot of those patients, and I usually don't have much to offer.
Yeah.
It used to be said that recurrent ischemia occurs in maybe 5% of cases. I think it's more than that now. Mm. Not much more than that. But, and usually they're women. What I try to do in that situation is I spend a lot of time talking to the patient. What season do you present in? There is a seasonality to this. Where do you live? Do you live in a hot climate? What do you do for exercise? How much do you sweat? What I'm trying to do is prevent them from getting dehydrated. Not that dehydration is the answer to everything, but it's one factor. So that's one thing. They always ask me, should I take an aspirin? Will that help? I think it probably wouldn't hurt.
Hmm.
No studies about aspirin in this. Do I need to go to the hospital with every episode? How many episodes have you had? 5. Is each one the same as every other one? Yes. How long does it last? 2 to 3 days. How sick are you by the second day? Not much. I said, can you drink anything by mouth? Yes. I said, you don't have to go to the hospital. If after the second day, you're not feeling the way you usually do, go to the hospital.
Birth control pills.
Birth control pills is something that went from a strong association to a weak association. The classic barium I showed you was a birth control pill, but it was many, many years ago. So the concentration of hormones are less today. Nonetheless, if a woman is on birth control pills and develop ischemic colitis, I tell her I don't want her to take them anymore. I had one patient, and usually the area of the colon that's involved in this recurrent phenomenon is the same area all the time.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I advise this patient not. And how often does it occur? Twice a year. Okay. How long does it last? 3 to 5 days. So that's not so terrible. You know, when you look at the alternative is taking out that part of your colon.
Right, right, right.
Do you want to have surgery for that? Or do you, you know? So this woman, against my advice, had that area of her colon resected. And about 6 months post-op, she had ischemia of another area of colon. And she had that area of colon removed. And eventually she lost her entire colon and had a an ileoproctostomy. And, you know, was now having 8 bowel movements a day and wasn't all that happy. I think it would have been better to have recurrent ischemic colitis.
Mm.
Because it's usually not a bad disease, and the episodes tend to be the way they are.
Did she have any autoimmune process that you
She had nothing.
Huh?
She had nothing.
The ANCA or?
Nothing.
Let me ask these guys, how much ischemic do you think we get, you know, on Chandler? You get like, I was trying to guess what our incidence is.
One every 2 or 3 months.
Oh, really? I was going to say more than that, but that's about right.
About 1 month.
So. Huh? About 1 month. Have you seen this isolated right colon thing? Have you guys seen any of this?
Thank God.
So I recently did a colonoscopy and saw a stricture outside the cecum that was clearly an old ischemic rim.
All right, so that's
no symptoms.
All right,
no,
that's nothing. An example of an irreversible
right, but she,
injury.
She didn't come. It was a pure screening.
Right.
My brain didn't even trigger to an angiogram because we had no idea how all this was.
I wouldn't do an angiogram in that situation. If she's asymptomatic, yeah. If he's asymptomatic, I would have left it alone. The short, those tend to be short stretches.
Oh yeah, just like a ribbon.
Yeah, and those I've seen several from. I've seen one with hepatitis B, and I've seen one from a periodontitis non-hepatitis B associated. And you know, I've dilated ischemic strictures. You can dilate them safely, although you have to do it carefully, like everything else. I put a stent in one.
How about for cirrhotic patients? Do you see ischemic colitis in cirrhotic patients? Because we have been some shows like, thickening in the right colon, maybe part of colopathy, but unable to rule out colitis, like when they do have pain. And they do have risk factors for ischemia, like hypertension, being a genotype for bleeding or
renal. I don't think I've ever seen an ischemic colitis in a cirrhotic patient.
A couple other drugs. Do you give them any advice? A 30-something-year-old professional, do you give them any advice regarding migraine medications, ergotamine type preparations, or ephedrine? Pseudoephedrine?
Well, you know, phenylephrine nose drugs, for example, has been associated, a weak association. So, you know, I take a look at the person, I see what medications they're on, ask them how healthy they are. I mean, I spend a lot of time talking about these things. And I would advise against anything that has been associated with colon ischemia because we really just don't know. And you've mentioned a couple of the more important ones. The migraine ones tend to be a little bit of a problem. Because they definitely have been associated with ischemic colitis. But, you know, migraine is also a terrible thing, and they have to look for other medications. But newer medications haven't been associated with ischemic colitis because, you know, the best time to use a medicine is when it first comes out because it has much fewer side effects.
Birth control pills are now being used for migraines too, so it'd be interesting to see if you get.
I did have an interesting patient. She was the administrator of a hospital, and she was a marathoner. And you know, marathon runners develop blood per rectum when they run, if not grossly, microscopically, you know, cold blood. And diarrhea is very common. So this woman said that if she were to run 3 miles, she would start to get cramps in her belly. When she ran 6 miles, she got the urge to move her bowels. If she ran 12 miles, she had diarrhea. And if she ran 18 miles, she had bloody diarrhea. She had quantified it.
That's cool.
So what I told her to do is, I would like you run an 18-mile loop and finish at your hospital, but call the radiologist the day you're going to do this and tell him you're going to be running into his unit at a certain time and then lie down and get an angiogram. Okay? This was a number of years ago. She didn't want. But there have
been studies. Well, your kid needs to be at risk because she's probably dehydrated. You nail her with that angio thing, you're going to wipe her kidneys out. She was smarter than you.
There are a lot of people who are smarter. Now, what was I going to say?
I didn't know, I know that it was reported, but I thought it was relatively rare.
It's actually not rare. Yeah. And there have been studies of marathoners, ultra-marathon runners, who have run the equivalent of a marathon on a treadmill, and with the angiogram catheter inside you, and looking to show that you get intense vasoconstriction of the gut. Because your gut isn't so important when you're running, you need muscle.
Can you duplicate that in animals by doing drugs?
We've never done that. I wanted to give her, I can't remember the chemical name. I actually wanted her to do that. And at that time, I wanted to give her a medicine like Viagra.
Oh, okay.
Right? So I called up the company making it, Park Davis. And I said to them, can you tell me what happens to mesenteric blood flow with Viagra? Now, you have to imagine that they know every vascular bed, right? They had no data that they could or would, I guess, share with me on the mesenteric circulation. They wanted to send me the data on penile blood flow. I said, I'm not interested in penile blood flow. I said, I'm interested in mesenteric blood flow, right? Because I wouldn't do it unless, you know, maybe penile blood flow increases because the mesenteric blood flow decreases, and that would be absolutely the wrong drug to give her. But I never could do
they
that.
Do stuff,
but that didn't matter because she never came back to me.
They do stuff like that for esophageal. Yeah, I mean, I know that the esophageal guys were doing that for some kind of esophageal disorders where they want to increase blood.
And pulmonary hypertension.
Oh, really? You know,
same way. It was a benefit that was discovered. Now it was actually first described for that, for central vascular problems. And I think in a guy with COR, I'm not sure. And it helped his problems. And it turns out that this guy had erectile dysfunction.
Oh my God.
Which disappeared when he took his medication. And when he told his doctor that, his doctor told the company that, they stopped making it for this and they started making it for that.
Wow.
So, isn't that interesting?
That's an uplifting story.
Billions now.
I wanted to get a rise out of it.
I mean, think about some of the, you know, really tough cases with ischemic that you've seen, because we see them.
We saw, sometimes it's very hard tissues in the large intestine, especially close to the rectum. Do you think there is any benefit to using mesalamine or carotid enemas or something to calm inflammation?
I've tried that. It doesn't work. I would advise you, I came across some problems when parenteral steroids were given to patients who were misdiagnosed as probably having. Word probably is a dangerous word in medicine. You do a lot of things based on probably that have bad results. Because people, prednisone or salicortef, whatever steroid you're using, inhibits tissue repair. And we've never proven it, but I think there's a higher perforation rate with ischemia. In patients treated for ischemic colitis with intravenous steroids. I don't know for certain, but I think there is. I have used, in a colitic type of presentation of ischemic colitis that lingered for a while and was causing diarrhea, but localized to a short segment, I've used steroid enemas with good result. And I've healed one case that had it for months with free fatty acid enemas.
One last question. You mentioned treatment for the ischemia, keeping the patient NPO. Why is that?
Oh, yeah, I think that's more of an old-fashioned kind of a thing. I don't think you have to keep them in PO. That was more for a sick patient, not the average patient. The average patient that comes in, unless you're going to be doing something, until the natural history of the disease unfolds, I think it's reasonable to keep them NPO. Once they start to feel better, I start them on clear liquids, and if they tolerate that, I just feed them, because by then they're almost ready to go home.
It's funny, one of the ladies that I had, I'm sorry, good, I told her to take a glass of Pedialyte before she went to sleep every night, and that stopped.
Stop what?
Stop the episodes of ischemic bowel.
Really?
So maybe, like you said, you know, just the hydration status was dropping.
Yeah, it could be. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yes.
Have you ever considered using fecal transplants for this?
For ischemic colitis?
For ischemic colitis.
No, I haven't. I don't know of any reports on microbiome in ischemic. Actually, there was one. I can't remember what they said, but you know, to take a patient with an ischemic colitis and do a microbiome analysis, I'm not sure what that really means. I'm sure that they have an abnormal microbiome at that time. Okay? Was it which was first, which was second? I don't really know. But, you know, and it would be a hard thing to do because, you know, most of these episodes are over in 3 to 5 days. 2 weeks at the most.
Right.
You know, you do a fecal transplant and they get better in 2 weeks. What have you learned?
Okay. Plus, I'm thinking if it's a really bad microbiome disease, we should see it here in Kentucky. we see some of the worst Crohn's I've ever seen in my life. I mean, I've actually had 4 patients die since I've been down here. And I do think a lot of it's related to the indigent populations that we see, and they're really horrible diet and vis-a-vis their horrible microbiome. So I think a lot of the diseases that we see, like the really bad Crohn's, is related. So I like your thinking, but I've also...
What mainly wonder about that is actually what you mentioned about the IBD serologies.
The what?
The IBD serologies.
Yeah.
Because some of those are responses to sensory fungi, right? Mm-hmm. Or different fungi.
We saw an issue, we saw a case.
Could hint towards an altered immune profile or like an altered microbiota, if you will.
No, but those serologies, we have a case, catastrophic venous occlusion. It's a pediatric thing. I don't know if anybody here does, remembers their peds. But
a neck?
It's not a neck. It's a catastrophic venous thrombosis. And I remember I had Bill Tremaine down and presented this case to him. It was not IBD. I got involved because I thought it might have been, but it was, and all those serologies were positive, and the lady turned out to not have IBD. So I think it was subsequent to all that immune activation and, you know, ischemic injury that,
you know, when you have a patient who is stressed, right, a lot of things happen. And you take a patient who's in a car accident, motor vehicle accident, and I was visiting a professor in Arizona, and I was talking about the microbiome and C. difficile and fecal transplant. And they had me meeting with a whole bunch of different departments. And I met with the head of their surgery department. He was a trauma surgeon. And he said, you know, I'm starting to do fecal transplants now. What I want to do is I want to do fecal transplants on my motor vehicle accident patients. And he said, what I want to do is I want to take a specimen of stool from them as soon as they come in, mm-hmm. and store it. And then I want to give it back to them later, because they all get antibiotics, they all get this, they all get that. Mm-hmm. And he said, they wind up dying of septic complications, he said, and I think if I replace their microbiota, that's not going to occur. Subsequent to his saying that, I saw several allusions to that fact. And it's similar to the, you know, if you're going to have an operation and you want to go in and give some blood to be held for you in case you need it after the operation or during the operation, you can do that. It's not a problem. But if you want to go in and donate a stool specimen and say, I want you to hold on to this because if I get C. difficile from the antibiotics you're giving in the hospital, I would like to have a fecal transfer with my own bacteria. They won't do that.
Oh, really?
They won't start them. That is an IRB project right there.
See, right? Back in the day, you could put flow meters in dogs and you didn't have those kind of problems, did you?
I won't tell you what I did back in the day. You say, you know, I'd like to take your spleen out tomorrow. We're doing a study. If you think it should be done, doctor, go ahead.
In the early days of C. diff, we used to, you know, I mean, we did donor. I mean, you say still do donors, you know, random donors, you have to screen them. I can't imagine why you couldn't get something passed. That wouldn't be
the I'll tell you the first fecal transplant I did. The first fecal transplant, and it speaks to your point. First fecal transplant was done, I did my first fecal transplant in 1990. Wow. There was no IRB. Patient came in and she said, I've had C. difficile. Prior to C. difficile, I was perfectly healthy. And then I got antibiotics for an upper respiratory thing. I got C. difficile. I can't get rid of it. It's been 6 months now. It's breaking my bank account. It's breaking my spirit. You have to come up with something to help me. And I'm thinking and thinking. I never heard of fecal transplant at the time. And I said, I just got a great idea. I said, you tell me you're perfectly healthy, you take the antibiotics, and then you're not healthy anymore. Maybe the antibiotics killed something in your GI tract, and if I can replace that, maybe you'd be better. She said, well, where would you get the something from? I said, see that good-looking guy sitting next to you on the couch? You've been married to him 50 years. I said, his bacteria should be the same as your bacteria. You've been exchanging everything for 50 years. So why not just take some of his stool and put it in your colon, see what happens? And he says, I can give you stool anytime you want. I said, why is that? He said, I have a colostomy. I said, why do you have a colostomy? He said, I had cancer a number of years ago. I said, that would be great. So, she said, when can you do this? I said, I'll do it Friday. We'll prep you tomorrow. I'll do it the next day. She said, great. So, she comes in. He gives me the stool. And actually, it was even worse than that. He gave me a stool. It looked like this. It was like a rock. Okay? So I said, you promised me a liquid stool. He said, well, it didn't happen today. So I reached in the cabinet, I got some saline. I said, make it liquid, right? And he stirred it up and it did all this stuff. And then I administered colonoscopically. I did that around, must have been about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, 2 o'clock in the afternoon. About 8 o'clock at night, she called me at home. She said, I just wanted to let you know, I don't know what you really did when you were in there. I feel like a new person. And she never got C. diff again. And that's the first case that I wrote up, and that sort of started the whole thing. And there was no IRB. And if there were an IRB, I wouldn't be in trouble. Huh?
They took you away in handcuffs.
No,
they didn't. They were very happy, and everybody was very happy.
Oh, yeah.
I never got IRB approval for fecal transplant. I never got hospital approval for it. The lawyers decided that I had been doing it, I knew how to do it, and they were fine with me doing it. Because there was no competition at that point, and it was just an oddball therapy that I did. And I didn't have to appeal before the IRB. It was a pre-existing thing, and I just did it. The only time I needed approval is when I wanted to do the double-blind randomized controlled trial for C. diff, and I had to get FDA approval for that. And I actually, that was my first R01 that I got to do that study.
That's pretty neat.
Very neat.
All right, guys, thank you so much.
Does the bowel prep decontaminate C. diff or will it help the transplant?
Yeah, probably not. Probably not.
Because they have spores and they'll come.
It doesn't seem to change anything.
Because they give it oral.
The data says it's not as effective. You're dealing with, if you want to just deal with open binding statistics, you're dealing with, they get a lower response than from patients.
I think the prep makes a difference, personally, because you're getting rid of
it's about,
you're talking about their capsules.
Well, going from the bottom up.
Yeah.
It's about 87% of the colon. It's about 83% of the upper tract. It's about 79% of the capsules.
Oh, okay.
Unless you do a double round of capsules. 35 followed by 35, and then it gets it back to the upper. But it does